He's after our soul. He's not the Lord's adversary. He's not God's adversary. Jesus has already defeated him. Death fell on the grave. He's our adversary, and he is a roaring lion seeking who he can devour, and he loves it whenever the focus is on us, our prayer life, or our experiences. But if our prayer, if our focus is on Christ and what he's done, he doesn't stand a chance.
Psalm 37:7. It says, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not yourself because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked devices to pass. And in your notes, it said, verses 3 through 7, we have the four keys to a victorious life: trust, delight, commit, and rest. And I thought that that was such a powerful way that you put that. Four keys to victory: trust, delight, commit, and rest. That's what so many people need to grab a hold of. Trusting in the finished work of Calvary, what Jesus did at the cross. Delighting in the finished work and a cross-centered life, meaning the light of the Lord. Like you said, the prayer as being cross-centered, you're giving praise and glory in your prayer time, delight. Committing yourself is not committing yourself to do a bunch of works, but to keep your focus and your perspective on the cross, and then to rest in the Lord, to know that God has you, that you're secure, because of your proper object of faith. You're secure because you are committed, you're trusting in Him. So you can have all of these things that are outlined in verses 3 through 7 in Psalm, resting in the Lord, fretting not, prospering, even when wicked people bring devices to pass, even when attacks come against you. How many people need to learn the concept of fret not? How many people live in anxiety? How many people live in depression? How many people worry because they don't trust, delight, commit, and rest in what Jesus did?
It ends in rest.
It ends in rest, and that's where people like me had to come to. That's where a lot of religious people have to come to.
So, Brother Sark, going back to the question of why is this not automatic? The statement in Colossians is he spoiled principalities and powers. We know that at Calvary, when he nailed the law to the cross, or the death that was hanging over our head, he stripped Satan of his legal authority over mankind. And we know that he spoiled, took away their authority. But why are we still, quote, wrestling? Because, as you said earlier, it's not automatic. If it were so, there'd never be enough Christian who would sin. If the Spirit's power and strength came automatically because we're simply in Christ, and I take what you said seriously, because there is a choice in the matter of what I'm going to trust in, and a daily choice. That's what Christ said. He said, deny yourself daily, take up the cross, follow me. If you do not do this, you cannot be my disciple. But the thought is, if they're spoiled, why am I still having to wrestle with principalities and powers? And obviously, I don't have a perfect answer, but I do know God is a perfect parallel with the children of Israel going into the land. You made the statement in your book, the world, the flesh, and the devil, incidentally, which everybody should buy and get. You mirror the chapter. I believe it's Exodus 12 through 15, maybe 15%. But here or there, you said this in that book. You said, before they walked into the land, God had already given the land to his people. They had to believe that he had already given it to them. And
it is 7:54.
As Caleb and Joshua are famed for saying, we are
going
to go and take the country. Where did that come from? They had to believe that God had already destined for them to live in victory and to take the land.
It was the evil ones that over there on earth.
There was also a battle. There was a wrestling. There was an exhibition of faith, trust. And so
there is always,
there has to be over. And God will allow principalities and powers to oppose us for the purpose of strengthening our hands, to teach us our hands to war, as David said. It's spiritual warfare. It's resisting the believer. And we wrestle is in the present tense. It's a fact, Jack. We are in a battle. It's happening ongoing, consistently. So those strategies of Satan to try to get us away from our power source, to try to get us to operate in the flesh, it's a very real battle, and it's ongoing. So again, it's not all about, as you said, I agree 100%.
There is such a difference now in my own heart and life. What it used to be and what it is now. And I'm sure I have a long ways to go yet, but I'm positive of that. But what a little piece of water is taking, it's joy and speakable in the Lord. And the true Christian experience is not fighting the devil and getting away. And that's not the real experience. It is the experience of far too many of us, but it's not God's way. And Satan is scared to death of the cross. He trembles at the name of Jesus. And it can be joy and spirit in front of the Lord.
For the record, it's really unbelief that keeps us from entering into the cross. Going back to what Joseph said, the children. Unbelief is you are not willing to surrender to what God has given. And that's an aspect of belief that many Christians don't understand, is that why surrender. So the children of Israel could not enter in because of unbelief. And in the same way, we as New Covenant believers, truly born again, baptized with the Holy Spirit, we don't enter into the victory that is in Christ because we won't surrender to what God has given us.
Right on what you just said, when the Lord first started opening up this great world to me, you know, like I said, I have a long ways to go yet, but I felt if our good assemblies of God and Church of God, whatever the case, if they just knew this, if they keep moving different. And I thought it was just ignorance, but I found out it was not, it was unbelief. You just don't believe what you're talking about.
Not willing to give themselves over to it, not willing to surrender to it.
Yeah, right. And that's really, you're right. That's the real problem.
You're taking that same story as Joshua and Caleb are standing before Israel saying, we are well able, these giants are bred for us, let's go take the country. They scream out, let's stone them. Let's get a new leader and go back to Egypt, to go back to slavery, to go back to they're on the cusp of having everything that God has given them. And they scream, let's destroy the believers, those that don't doubt God's way and God's promise, and let's go back to the thing that destroyed us. I mean, that's
such a giant shame. Lord, let me go back into the world.
Exactly. And it's the same thing that we see today, and it's people that will hear this message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, but say, that can't be it. There's got to be more. Let's stone the messenger. Spiritually, not literally stone him, but let's take him out, let's destroy his character, because we just don't agree with what they're saying, and let's go back into the way that has never worked.
Yeah, never worked is right. We've run out of time as well, and let me encourage you, please, to tell others about the program, the network, as many of you do, and we're so grateful for that.
foundation of the Declaration of Independence. The preamble of the Constitution concisely adopted the principles of the Declaration and adapted those principles to build a structured form of government, a representative republic. This young republic would represent the moral fortitude of its founders and the spiritual values of its people. It would be evident that this new form of government was built on the bedrock of biblical principles. The American national consciousness, one observer wrote, is not a voice crying out of the depth of the dark past, but is proudly a product of the enlightened present, setting its face resolutely toward the future. American exceptionalism was the embodiment of a stirring ideal. Since the arrival of the Pilgrims, many thought of America as a chosen vessel for a special role in God's great plan, as the Constitution put it, to ensure the blessing of liberty. Pastor Jonathan Edwards said, God chose America as the glorious renovator of the world. John Adams proclaimed the opening of America as a grand scheme and design in providence for the illumination and the emancipation of the slavish part of mankind all over the earth. This mission Adams spoke of was the call to lead the world for greater liberty. But there were problems that still needed to be addressed. Before the Revolutionary War, colonists knew only struggles. The struggle to survive, the struggle to overcome oppression, the struggle to break away from the bonds of tyranny. But having accomplished the unimaginable in victory over the British, citizens now found themselves in their own country living in peace. With men like Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, and John Adams laying the foundation for the growing nation to stand upon, could anything go wrong? Nothing born of God can remain untested, and a great trial was on the horizon for the young American nation. At the dawn of the 19th century, people's activities began to drift in different directions, drawing distinct divisions in three regions of the young country. In the north, it was industry. In the south, agriculture. And in the west, expansion. However, just like the years before the first great awakening, an overprivileged populace began turning their backs on God again. America's worldly pursuits were taking priority, and they were leaving providence behind.
The United States of America was beginning to prosper in the new century. Many who lived and fought in the Revolutionary War were finally able to use their gifts and talents for a greater purpose. Canals were now being built up and down the Ohio and Mississippi River system, providing an efficient and economical new way of shipping. One of God's greatest gifts to the United States is its system of rivers. But at the turn of the 19th century, America had barely begun to tap into their potential. That is until 1807, when a New Yorker by the name of Robert Fulton demonstrated American ingenuity with the invention of a steam-powered boat that could travel upstream. Two-way commerce was now a reality, and the efficient use of the river systems was fully realized. As the infrastructure for shipping goods expanded, so did the ability to spread the word of God. Evangelists and missionaries embarked into the American frontier, bringing with them only their Bibles and the conviction to carry Christianity onward into the Western horizon. Thomas Jefferson found himself working tirelessly, moving from one public office to another, but always moving onward, both in prominence and power. He served the United States as governor of Virginia, diplomat to France, secretary of state, vice president, and eventually the President of the United States. As President, Jefferson understood the benefit to Native Americans having access to the Word of God. Knowing the power of the gospel, he wanted to provide it to the indigenous population. But he was given counsel that the King James Bible would only confuse the Native Americans. In response, President Jefferson personally condensed and consolidated the biblical teachings of Jesus into what he aptly named the Philosophy of Jesus of Nazareth. This companion text allowed the native nations to read about Jesus in a simpler form, and then move on to the King James translation. His work was wildly successful, but Jefferson wasn't finished with the Bible. In 1820, Jefferson compiled a personal collection of verses that he called The Life and Morals of Jesus of Nazareth. A senator was so stirred by the collection that he compelled the United States government to print and provide a copy of Thomas Jefferson's Life and Morals of Jesus of Nazareth to every congressman and senator for the next 50 years. A lesser known but equally important founding father, Benjamin Rush, was essential to the American Revolution. Educated in person, Rush was a prominent advocate for many causes, including the abolition of slavery, women's rights. It was Rush who trained in the States, Lewis and Clark, prior to their journey westward. It was Rush who lobbied for educational standards and prison reform. It was Rush that reconciled John Adams and Thomas Jefferson in their later years. But above all others, his faith was held highest. I do not believe that the Constitution was the offspring of inspiration, but I am as perfectly satisfied that the Union of the United States, in its form and function, is as much the work of divine providence as any of the miracles recorded in the Old and New Testament, Dr. Benjamin Rush. Unlike the nations of the Old World, which had storied histories, the United States was the infant republic swathed in the age of the With innovation came expansion, and the people of America were spreading westward. But as the country flourished, the church and faith became secondary, too busy to read the Bible, too busy for God. The young American nation was asleep, intoxicated by the ill-informed illusion of their own greatness. They were now in desperate need of a new spiritual wake-up call. Throughout the course of history, it's easy to see.
What America needed now was a
Once again, we want to welcome back to Preachers, Patriots, and Providence, Brother Ben Kinsler, who was with us a few weeks ago on our third episode. And in that episode, we discussed the first Great Awakening. This episode, we want to be discussing the second Great Awakening and the influence that it had on the United States of America. And I want to get your opinion on the difference between the first Great Awakening and the second Great Awakening and why it was necessary.
When we look at what we call the second Great Awakening, what we find out was this was the basis for something we would know today as social reform. Well, even though the first Great Awakening, some great things happened for America and California, around the Kingdom of God and England and fight independence. There were some things that were happening in America that were contrary to the principles of the first, of the spiritual principle of the Great Awakening. Slavery, for example. Women were discriminated against. There was no such thing as women's suffrage, and various things like that were happening in America at this point in time. And when the Second Great Awakening came along, it started to change how people viewed one another. And the fact of the matter is that it was social reform that took place out of this that led largely to the Civil War because of the devotion of the people to religion. So they ever supplied Christian teachings to the resolution or the solving of social problems that they were experiencing back in those days.
Whenever the Bible is preached and the Spirit of God moves, it always brings to the forefront the ills of a nation and the ills of the human heart, which is sin. And it will bring out, as you brought out, the fact that women were being discriminated against. We saw the beginning of the suffrage movement because of this. Slavery, the mistreatment of a large portion of our citizens. And, you know, I was preaching one Sunday morning, and I made this statement at church that historians call the Civil War a matter of a war over states' rights and slavery, but I said it was really a spiritual conflict. It was Satan's attempt to destroy this nation from the inside, and he was using race to do it. And Satan, knowing that God had a great plan for America, that America was slowly becoming the light of the gospel to the world. But how could we give the gospel to the world when we imprisoned and enslaved a segment of our citizens? And there had to be a war. This horrible sin had to be eradicated.
Oh, no question about that. You see, because what happened is, really understand that the efforts, the Christian teaching has to be applied for everybody. And if it doesn't apply to all, then it's just like the religions in all these other states. So Christianity, not being religion, has transcendent principles that should apply equally to everyone. And this will resolve almost all of our social problems now, just like it started to address the social problems they were facing back in the 19th century. Because back then, Congress were taught that if you wanted to achieve salvation, it was more than just walking down to the front and repenting. They needed to repent not only of personal sin, but they also needed to work for what they would call the moral perfection in society. In other words, it meant eradicating all the things that were done in society that were contrary to what the Word of God taught. Those were people who were in the church practicing the principles on which they taught where the Christianity was based, and that they applied to everybody, not just to a certain select group of people.
Yeah, in other words, it was Christianity is not just 1 hour on Sunday, but it is something that is to be 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, in every aspect
said, oh, no, no, they have this for their temperance movement. Women did not have all the equal rights that they are accustomed to. They didn't have the right rights. They had no rights. They were held under the domain of the male. And then, of course, we talked about slavery, and they said, well, you can't do this. This is not right. And all of these are based on spiritual principles articulated in Scripture.
Exactly. Let me ask you this question. We see that one of the things that most people don't realize is that in the way the first Great Awakening and the second Great Awakening, that America became a nation of drunkenness. Alcohol became so prevalent, it began to destroy the lives of men. It began to destroy industry even because men would be too hungover to work. But then we begin to see the second Great Awakening and then revivals like the Cane Ridge revivals that broke out in Kentucky and the Appalachians. And we see a sobering up, so to speak, of America to the point that in some towns revival would come and every saloon in town would close down.
That's right, because the people who went to these revivals came away with moral precepts. They became moral in their lives, and they believed that reform was a part of God's plan for mankind. So they saw themselves as members of the local church or as having been saved these conventions as being, we are the ones to whom God can bring salvation to the world through changes of the laws that we abide by, laws to have or don't have, and the creation of some certain institutions. And so the right design of that was the desire to transform not just themselves, but the world.
I was studying the Sermon on the Mount just the other day, and the Lord in that great sermon, the greatest sermon ever preached, because it came from the lips of the Master.
Yes, sir.
And he said that, speaking of believers, he said we are the salt of the earth. And we know that salt, to use salt as a metaphor, to speaking of that, it's Christians that are the preservers of life, liberty, happiness, peace, joy, because we have the true light. Then he said, we're the light of the world. And then he said, we are a city on a hill. And he was saying, you'll be so transformed that wherever you go, they will know that you are a Christian. You are a child of God. And we see these revivals transforming the lives of people that were, it was like light springing up out of darkness everywhere they went, because they then became salt, light, and that city on a hill.
Exactly. And it didn't just apply to those people who were getting up out of the pews and going back to working in the local area. It applied to the leaders of our country as well, because the people held them responsible. And that is why the American form of government at its best is so different from all the rest of the forms of government, because it applied to the people that were being governed, but it applied also equally to the people that were doing the governing. So you can have anything like the King of England and the Queen of England, who had no, quote, principles in which they had to abide by. The same principles work for the guy that was walking behind the mule. That same principle, thou shalt not murder or thou do not commit adultery, applied to the guy who was also sitting in the White House in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, exactly. And we see, you know, when we study our early presidents, their correspondence and their constant, you know, not saying that we don't know the heart of a man. And so we're not saying that every president in a certain period of time was truly born again. But there was a knowledge and a respect for the things of God and things that were holy. And they were not afraid of attributing the hand of God to the majesty of what was becoming this country called America.
Absolutely. If you just compare the writings of the founding fathers, the writings of Jefferson and Franklin and Washington, with the writings that you see from our top political leaders today, any semblance, any resemblance of those
None whatsoever.
And what is the primary difference?
There was an influence of Christianity and the Bible in the lives of these men. You know, and that's why, you know, I said on another program that we have more elected officials today that have no influence of the Word of God or Christianity. You know, it used to be that our elected leaders, they may have been scoundrels, but they had enough knowledge of the Bible to know, I can't say that, or I can't do that, because I won't get reelected. But that doesn't fly anymore, because nobody knows the Bible anymore when it comes to our political leaders. But, you know, I don't want to veer too far off the subject. One thing I wanted to discuss with you is the influence of Christianity and the Bible in early education in America. And that our educational system, as it is today, is 180 degrees opposite from what it was founded to be. Can you expound on that for us?
Well, I don't think there's much question about that, because we have taken every reference to God nowadays is almost completely, totally taken out of our education process. You can't teach that anymore because of this misunderstanding of the First Amendment, separation of church and state. That's not what the founding fathers had in mind. That's not what they were talking about. Because they turned right around and said, not only that, but you cannot prohibit people from the free exercise of their religion. In other words, you cannot prohibit people from worshiping God wherever it is they want to do it. If people want to pray in church, fine. If they want to pray on their job, fine. As long as they've done a fair with their job. So today what we have is people saying, no, you cannot practice your religion because of the separation of church and state. So you cannot bring religion into the public square. And that is totally antithetical to what the founding fathers had in mind when they brought this founding line. I've recorded this time and time again, but I've got to say it one more time. All these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal and endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. So what that says is, I have rights from my creator that you, as a government official, do not have the right to override. Simple as that.
We hope you enjoyed season one of the SBN original program, Preachers, Patriots, and Prophets. We're now offering the entire season of 8 episodes on DVD. You'll relive the account of men and women who established a new nation whose cornerstone was the Word of God, with freedom and liberty for all. To purchase season one of Preachers, Patriots, and Prophets, go to shopjsn.org. Vociferously. The Sunday morning service was the tipping point of the Cane Ridge Revival. A mighty move of the Holy Spirit swept the crowd. People by the thousands were saved by the Spirit and began crying out to the Lord. What took place at this camp meeting shook the very foundation of the frontier. A monumental moment not only in American history, but also in church history. The second Great Awakening in America was alive. Before the events of the Cane Ridge Revival, not many had ever heard of a camp meeting. And its meaning was simple. A revival lasting several days, with people traveling from near and far to take part in a shared time of praise and Christian fellowship and worship. It was a time of praise, a time of devotion, and a time of healing. Early in the 19th century, a camp meeting was simply that, a camp out. There were no modern conveniences on the frontier. Families would travel for days from lands far and wide to hear the preaching of circuit riders and evangelists. They constructed camps and tents of canvas and cloth were fashioned in open fields. Local vendors would set up shop throughout the week selling goods to the visiting families. Some camp meetings would build raised wooden platforms spread over hundreds of yards across the encampment so that multiple preachers could minister at once without their voices overwhelming one another. And remember, they didn't have sound system. The pastors would preach from elevated platforms so their voices could carry far enough to reach the people. These rough, rugged revivals are a thing of the past. But while the outward appearance may have changed with the contemporary conveniences of hotels, air conditioning, and modern church buildings, but on the inside, the heart of revival still remains the same. Much can be said about the long-lasting effects of the Cane Ridge Revival alone. But that was only a small portion of what was taking place all across America at that time. Spiritual lightning was striking all over the country. Second Great Awakening was spreading like wildfire throughout the United States. In the North, older denominations were awakened once more. Slavery and alcoholism waned as preachers convicted their crowds with sermons of abolition and temperance. Education and women's rights were emboldened as the Bible was heralded as the center of understanding and wisdom. However, in the southern states, the Methodists and Baptists were seeing a different story unfold. The social reform movements of the North did not have the same effect, where slavery was so deeply ingrained in the culture and the economy. Approaching that polarizing issue with caution, ministers would appeal to the hearts and minds of the individual, preaching the gospel to change each person from the inside, in the hopes that God would light their way. The ministers trusted the Holy Spirit to do the work. The Second Great Awakening for the northern and southern states was a revival of the Spirit, like the rekindling of embers in a dying fire. Though many were Christian in name only, at least there was a foundation for the preachers to build on. But on the western frontier, most were simply not religious, much less Christian.
Following of Cane Ridge, ministers found ready and willing audiences among the lonely western landscape. They were hungry for the Holy Spirit to be yearning for their community. African Americans were especially attracted to the New American Baptist churches. Richard Allen, who later helped to found the African Methodist Episcopal Church, said in 1787, there was no religious sect or denomination that would suit the capacity of the colored people, as well as the Methodists. Allen realized that this plain and simple approach spreading the gospel suited all people. Free men and slave alike worshipped in these congregations, with one community of worship. Revivals offered a redemptive social model to isolated rural communities, particularly the women, for whom the camp meetings provided well-threaded records of loneliness of far life. Evangelical ministers often what had been traditionally male roles bolstered women's self-worth and expanded their horizons beyond the domestic sphere, a monumental achievement in women's rights. We focus on more famous founders like William Bradford, George Washington, and James Madison. But names like Frances Abbotsford, one of the many you may not have heard of, can also stand out as one of our spiritual founding fathers. No, he didn't sign the Declaration of Independence. He didn't help frame the Constitution. He never served as President of the United States, nor any other political office of government. But he was one of God's chosen vessels, carrying the gospel of Jesus Christ through a new and developing American nation. Asbury established a mobile brand of evangelism that was perfectly suited to the frontier environment. He scouted the Appalachian frontier for lost souls, covering more than a quarter of a million miles by horseback. He personally ordained more than 4,000 preachers and preached more than 16,000 sermons over the course of his ministry. His message changed thousands of lives during his lifetime, weaving together the spiritual fabric of the American frontier. He labored to bring the greatest form of freedom to a land that had become far too complacent with its newfound liberty. Prior to the Second Great Awakening, most pioneers saw circuit preachers as a form of entertainment. It was something to take their minds off of the long days and the harsh lives of homesteaders. In frontier life, if you had a problem, you had to deal with it yourself. You had little support to protect you from Indian attacks, unrelenting weather, disease, and starvation. But as the wildfire of revival raged in the Appalachian Mountains, frontier families realized that the church and Christian fellowship would be the answer. In a matter of months, circuit riding preachers saw a desire for change from homeless to towns. They were sending letters to the preachers asking them to come to their towns. They wanted to experience what they had heard about in places where they lived. Preachers made their own mess, though not as gentle workers, but spirit-filled resources. Drunkenness, violence, and sexual promiscuity were attacked. The covetous, the thieves, the swindlers, and fools all directly brought to charge. In Psalms 23:4, the Bible says, "Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." But the Lord uses that staff not only in protection, but in correcting the direction of his flock. These Methodist and Baptist circuit riders didn't come as lambs to pander philosophy, but as lions to roar the word of God. And when God's preachers don't move back, neither does God. Bars closed and
closed.
Families children at home instead of crawling inside of a bottle. Entire communities were transformed as the drunken shanties and raucous revelry switched to songs of praise and worship and cries of admonition. Like rotting and overripe fruit, America's spiritual self had fallen away into a state of decay. But after the Second Great Awakening, a new seed sprouted in the heart of America. America as a nation had been born again.
As the Second Great Awakening spread of the Americas, another Reformation was taking place among the children of the U.S. The New England Primer had been used for nearly 100 years as the most basic textbook for schools in the colonies. It was a teaching resource for basic reading and writing in English. But in teaching basic English, it used biblical references and Christian moral lessons. Students were to learn that in Adam's fall, we sinned all onto the letter B. Thy life to men, this book. It was meant to be a consolidated source for students to memorize idioms easily so they could recite them while working the fields or learning their trade. Primary schools in early 19th century America were often overcrowded. Levels of learning did not separate the students, so progress was often slow and frustrating. But God had called a man to change the way Americans learned, Noah Webster.
The young Webster studied at Yale University during the American Revolution under Ezra Stiles. And it was here that he connected the Bible and its infallible connection to learning. Noah Webster looked at the deplorable situation in American schoolhouses and surmised solutions to solve the scholastic issues in America. So he set a system of levels which pupils must master before moving to the next level. For example, young children should first learn the English alphabet, studying vowels and consonants, before moving on to learning how the letters make up words. From learning words and their meaning, they could then use the words to form simple sentences. This may be commonplace in the modern world, but when Noah Webster proposed these ideas, they were seen as revolutionary. The system was an instant success, but Webster found another problem. A wide variety of textbooks were being used, and most were outdated English textbooks, hundreds of years old. He wanted to create a high-quality resource for all students, so in 1806, he began writing what we now know as Webster's Dictionary. During the Second Great Awakening, Christian education was to be released from the select
group and
be given available to the people.
Dope run.
Through Webster's learning and his dictionary, for generations to come, Americans would depend on the Bible as the cornerstone of education. Education is useless without the Bible. The Bible was America's basic textbook in all fields. God's Word, contained in the Bible, has furnished all necessary rules to direct our conduct. Noah Webster. As believers, we often lose our way. We're only human after all. We start off our Christian walk with the Lord with vigor and fire. But in one fell swoop, the world, the flesh, and the devil can grab us right by the throat and choke the spiritual life out of us. History shows us, however, that the providence of God is always at work. During times of great apathy, he's not asleep. As the second lightning began to strike in America, God would begin to call forth men not only to teach the men and women, the young boys, as we call them, Enter Timothy Dwight, the president of Yale University. He resolved to purify a campus that had turned into a hotbed of infidelity. For more than 7 years, Dwight, grandson of the great revivalist Jonathan Edwards, preached a series of weekly sermons on the doctrines of Christianity on the college campus at Yale. The students were captivated. In his first year of teaching and ministry alone, nearly half the student body gave their hearts to the Lord. One man wrote, "Yale College is a little temple. Prayer and praise seem to be the delight of the greater part of the students, while those who are still unfeeling are awed with respectful silence." And oh, did I mention that Yale originated as a Christian college? The fervor of revival fanned the flames of righteous renewal across the country and was compared to that of fast-moving forest fires. Just like evergreen forests, a cleansing fire is necessary for new growth, as the ashes of the excess provide nourishment for new life. Western New York, in fact, experienced such intense levels of evangelical activity that it was labeled the Burned Over District. The most successful evangelist in the Burned Over District was quite literally the spiritual successor of Timothy Dwight. His name was Charles Finney. Finney was a vibrant, fiery lawyer, but under Dwight's ministry at Yale, he quickly felt the call of God in his life. He would bring that same righteous fire to the pulpit. Finney preached marathon, fire, and brimstone revivals all the time. He carried the methods of the frontier revival to the cities and the factories of the East and as far as Great Britain.
Thanks, good hearing, go in there.
Finney accepted the professorship of theology at the newly established Oakland College. From the start, Oakland College radiated the spirit of reform, predicated on faith. It was the first college in America to admit women and black men. It would be the grassroots hub of the anti-slavery abolition movement. His dynamic personality
ain't no further reader. You seen the Queen of Queens
changes that
not alone.
Completely unheard of before his time. He organized choirs
of praise
and worship and actively advertised and promoted his revival so that people could play in once and bands. Many also consider him to have shaped the modern concept of the octagon. But perhaps one of the greatest hallmarks of his ministry was reform. As a strong proponent of the abolition of slavery, Benny believed the gospel did not merely affect the salvation of a soul, but could also cure the ills of society. He encouraged Christians to get involved in their communities, and he worked tirelessly to see society change by the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Let's go back to our discussion with Ben Kinchlow as we learn more about early American education and its Christian roots. Brother Kinchlow, you have seen America change from a God-fearing nation to a nation that is, I wake up every morning wondering, is this republic going to hold? Is this union going to hold? Because there is so much hatred and animosity and friction and unbelief and segments of groups of people trying to push ungodly lifestyles, and the list can go on and on and on. And then I look back to our founding fathers and I say, where are the men today that were there then? That's what we need. We need men of conviction to stand up and lead America back to righteousness. And I think it begins in the pulpit.
You don't have to go over to the founding fathers. You can go just right back to my lifetime. I'm not all that old. But if you go back to my lifetime, there were things that were absolutely illegal for black people to do. I cannot walk in the same restaurant with you. I could sit down on the same bus seat with you. I could go to the same restaurant with you.
And talk about
transgender bathrooms. We had transgender bathrooms. I had gone in transgender bathrooms when I was a young man. Because there were restrooms for white men,
right,
restrooms for white women, and then there was one restroom for color. So men and women, back in the day, colored men and women had to use the same restroom. There were people led by Dr. Martin Luther King and people like that who got together, marched, prayed, and the righteous people of this country got together and said, no, that's wrong. We cannot have that in America. So they changed all of that stuff. And in 1964, they wrote the Civil Rights Act. 1965, the Voting Rights Act. And so, things that I could not do, and could not even dream of doing, when I was the age of my grandchildren, today, there's nothing my grandchildren cannot do in this country.
Declare that I believe that there will be a third great awakening in this nation before the Lord comes, because I still believe the best for the church is ahead, and the best for the nation is ahead, because God is not through with us. How would you have that?
Well, it could be, but there is a condition. In the, one of the biggest words in the Bible is a two-letter word called if.
I've preached that before.
If my people to call by my name, to humble themselves, pray, turn from their wicked ways, seek my face, then will I hear from heaven, and I will come and heal their land. So what happens to us in the future, what happens to our country in the future, rests firmly in the hands, the clenched hands, which will be folded in prayer, up to our Heavenly Father. And if we don't do that, then we alone will be responsible for what happens to what is, up to this point, arguably the greatest country on the face of the earth. And let me just point out something. I want to say, from the standpoint of someone who spent most of his military career outside of the United States, let me just tell you, if you've never been outside of the United States of America, you cannot imagine what a privilege it is to live in this country. It is beyond our ability to express. You can only know it from experience. And I don't mean staying in a hotel in the Bahamas. I'm talking about seeing how the rest of the world lives. Then come back here. One final thought. Let me ask you this question. You see people flooding into America by the millions, don't you?
Absolutely.
Let me ask you this. How many people do you see flooding out?
Absolutely. Absolutely. There's a line waiting to get in, but there's no line trying to get out. And because of God's blessing upon this nation, we want to thank Brother Ben Kinchlow for being our guest in episode 7 of Patriots and Providence. I want to thank him and commend him for his service to the kingdom of God. And I want to recommend once again, let me just say it again, to get his book, Black, Yellow, Dogs. And it's not meaning it's what you think. It's a take on an old Southern statement, Yellow Dog Democrat. And it's really his story, to be honest with you, because he shares his testimony of what God has done in his life, but he also brings a part of history that we need to know. And you can order this book on Amazon.com or BenKinchlow.com. Once again, Brother Kinchlow, thank you for being so gracious to take of your time to be with us on Preachers, Patriots, and Providence. And I hope the next time I talk to you, it won't be by Skype, but it will be face to face. I love you, and God bless you, sir.
Well, it's my privilege, my honor, and a fear is mutual, sir.
Thank you, and God bless you.
Every moment of the day when you came to the world to establish a new nation is captured in the light of liberty. From season 1 of the Sunlight Broadcasting Network's original program, Preachers, Patriots, and Providence, the evangelist studies my connection from Plymouth Rock to Pennsylvania Avenue, and from the Declaration of Independence to the Bill of Rights, showing how the United States of America was the ultimate testimony to any nation founded on the Word of God. To order the book, Light of Liberty, go to shopjsn.org. The Second Great Awakening provided one of the most powerful movements for social reforms during that century, and the fires of revival carried over oceans just as easily as it carried over mountains. Temperance, abolition, and women's rights became the targets of reform in the early 19th century. Individuals like Lyman Beecher stressed that the Second Great Awakening was not focused simply on promoting individual conversions to Christ, but was also intended to reform human society. He took a harsh stand against the abuse of alcohol from behind the pulpit, and went on to publish several of his sermons that quickly found their way to the hands of thousands of
Henry Ward Beecher was one of the most respected evangelists of his day and became a staunch advocate for women's rights. His daughter, Harriet, took on the role as a devoted abolitionist and went on to publish one of the most cherished novels in American history, Uncle Tom's Cabin. It would have been thought impossible only 50 years before, a female author writing a story promoting Christian values, the equality of women, and the abolition of slavery. The winds of change were blowing, and the Lord was leading the way. The spreading of the gospel had given the 1800s an appropriate name, the Protestant Century.
As he so often does, God raised up men of faith to proclaim his gospel at the turn of the 19th century. Men such as Timothy Dwight, Charles Finney, Francis Asbury, Mary Mosher, and Martin Sloane were raised up for such a time as this. Out of the second great awakening, the American people were beckoned back to the Lord. This great spiritual resurgence fundamentally altered the character of the American landscape. The evangelical impulse at the heart of this cross-country revival shared the same spirit of revolutionary ideals. The immense success of the Second Great Awakening was also furthered by innovative organizational techniques within evangelical churches. These new practices were tailored specifically to the frontier conditions of newly settled territory. Most evangelical churches relied on itinerant preachers to reach large areas without an established local pastor that also included important places for the laity who took on major religious and administrative roles within evangelical congregations. But perhaps the most intriguing development of all is the increase in public roles for women and African Americans in the church. The strides toward equality that were made by the church in this short time were absolutely remarkable. God provided an anchor for the American soul, not only in spreading his word, but also by sending preachers and teachers to help the people to understand. The Second Great Awakening calmed the troubled soul of America and set the course back to God's way. In closing, I would like to thank Mr. Ben Kinslow. And I will leave with a quote from French scholar, the top note. He was sent to America by France to discover as a nation been so fruitful and successful in such a He said, there is no country in the history of the world which Christianity holds a greater influence over the souls of its citizens than mine. Upon my arrival in the United States, the religious aspect of the country was the first thing that struck my attention. And the longer I stayed there, the more I perceived the great political consequences resulting from this new state of things. In France, I had almost always seen the spirit of religion and the spirit of freedom marching constantly. But in America, I found that they were intimately united and that they reigned in common over the same country. Religion must be regarded as the foremost of the political institutions of that country. For if it does not impart a taste for freedom, it facilitates the use of it. Indeed, it is in this same point of view that the inhabitants of the United States themselves look upon religious belief. I do not know whether all Americans have a sincere faith in their religion, for who can search the human heart? But I am certain that they hold it to be indispensable to the maintenance of Republican institutions. This opinion is not peculiar to a class of citizen or a party, but it belongs to the whole nation and to every rank of society.
Thank you, man.
came into Pentecost. It is a story that you need to hear as an end time message, as healing music, or praise the Lord. But also as a very special bonus gift, your purchase of the CD DVD combo Sound from Heaven, you're going to receive Dad's music CD entitled The Healing Jesus. Absolutely free as a bonus gift with every purchase. Now you can see the address on the screen, or it's easier to go online and you can see that address as well. Don't miss out on this special offer.
You probably heard the rumors by now, and the rumors are true. IYC is back, and it's better than ever. There's going to be anointed praise and worship, anointed preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, workshop for all ages, activities for the kids and the teenagers, and an attendee favorite the last couple of years, our worship baptismal service. I'm expecting God to do great things. Come and join us in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, July 24th through the 28th.
Late night will come tomorrow.
Please do. Oh, Well, I'm gonna watch him.
He said, you know, he said, I don't understand it all, but he said, I value you and the Pentecostal movement, and I know it's real. And he said, his statistic, he said, I know there's 500 million Pentecostals out there. He said, I can't deny the moving of the Holy Spirit in these days. He said, you know, I don't teach it and preach it, but he said, I'm definitely not against it. Because he had been out on the cornfield and he had seen what God had done. He had prayed for people and seen people healed divinely. And he had seen colleagues of his who had been called praying for people and they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and God moved all over them. And it was undeniable what was happening. The miracles of God were they had to be of God to see that result. So that's they all. Just, you know, come over completely. the externals that have been so hurtful and bound to some degree from smoking the tobacco today and the Copenhagen and the pills and all the rest of it. Those externals were eliminated, and it was another 3 months after that before I was baptized with the Holy Spirit.
But the Spirit of God worked in your heart and life.
That's the only one who could have delivered me from that. And every single born-again believer has that capability. That's what we need to teach.
You were delivered from nicotine. A dear lady sitting very close to you in church on a Sunday morning gave an utterance in tongues.
Right. That is true. I came into the presence of a Pentecostal denomination, but I wasn't baptized with the Holy Spirit
at that time.
Well, it took another 3 months before I was actually baptized, but it was that day that the work of the Holy Spirit that I received in salvation manifested itself in freedom from cigarettes. So, don't tell people what the Holy Spirit cannot do in them. Don't do that. He's not limited. He's only limited by our faith. And when we, as Pentecostals, say, well, he doesn't do that until you're baptized, we're limiting people. We're hurting people. And when we tell people the Holy Spirit doesn't do that anymore, we're hurting people and we're hurting the work of God.
My hope is will. My hope is will come nonetheless.
Yeah.
That Jesus' blood and righteousness. I will not trust the sweetest frame, but hope in me on the dear name. On Christ the Son, rock I stand. All else is sinking sand. All else is sinking sand. When the person gets saved, what our dear brother wrote some 300, 400 years ago, it holds true in their life immediately when they find the Christ.
We remember that spring day of 1966 under that Walmart's campaign when I was healed.
Back from the dope room. Chips in the bag. Dope room is going to make it many more today. And you'll see him. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
met them up at the gas station. They do. Yeah, but I didn't want to just show up and talk to her. She wait like she knows somebody. You know me. Just, yeah, you the man from a lot of places around here. You know who's doing that? Upstairs. The evil one.
I get it on the stove. I will heat up the house of the oven, but okay. I'm not gonna do it every day. I'll just get some chips and hot dogs and just go. It's grandma got a dope addiction.
Well, they all do.
Any more time,
if you don't go. That's a gas station. Pet mall. On 141. Right across from Valley Park Elementary School.
Good school.
But she's saying they stealing her pull of her wife.
They gotta watch his ass, if you don't. Lord Jesus, thank you.
Thank you.